Good evening, my name is Cheryl Pham and I'm a resident of Inwood and I'm one of the founding members of the Northern Manhattan Community Land Trust. This rezoning, which is the most significant potential change in Northern Manhattan in decades, is being advanced primarily for the benefit of people who do not live here now. Efforts by the community at the table and to influence what ultimately happens in our neighborhood, but it's been an increasingly and unnecessarily difficult struggle. Even though we have a mayor with a stated commitment to support low-income and underrepresented communities, there are so many unheard voices: seniors, small business owners, artists. The thousands of Inwood residents who live in Dyckman houses have been entirely left out of any conversation. All we have to do today is read the news to see the harm that our government's neglect causes. A mother of young children is in a coma after rescuing her family from an apartment fire because NYCHA failed to replace her stove that she complained about multiple times because the burners turned on by themselves. While she lives on the Upper West Side, the point is that our leadership has turned a blind eye to her because she is poor. Despite all the talk about public investments in the Inwood plan, we've heard nothing about the condition of buildings in the Dyckman Houses development, whether tenant complaints are being addressed timely and effectively, or whether there'll be any improvements in public spaces or community services used by the entire community in the Dyckman Houses development. And public housing is a critical yet invisible resource toward achieving the mayor's goals of reducing homelessness and creating stable neighborhoods. The Inwood plan is overly focused on what developers want: tall buildings and high rents. It's not about the people who live here. For example, we've heard nothing about creating quality jobs for people without college degrees, people who were formerly incarcerated, or people who are disabled or chronically ill. And by the way, retail wages won't adequately support families and certainly won't enable them to afford the rents in the Inwood plan. Thousands of residents who pay preferential rents are at even greater risk of displacement under rezoning than they are now, but the Inwood plan doesn't even acknowledge that the risk exists. It assumes incorrectly that these leases are rent regulated, but the reality is that people are being economically displaced right now because landlords are charging rent increases upwards of $300 a month. All this talk of rezoning is just incentivizing landlords to be more aggressive with their tenants. The issue of preferential rents directly affects low-income and middle-class residents. But community residents have been aggressive at holding EDC, our councilman, and the mayor to account. And we've really tried to create a more inclusive, interactive process. And that's why we are working to build a community land trust toward the goal of creating community-controlled, permanently affordable housing and community facilities. Council for recognizing community land trusts as viable pathways to achieving truly affordable housing. But to succeed at serving low-income communities, community land trusts are going to need the city to create affordable financing mechanisms, such as a revolving loan fund seeded with fees charged to developers, and to create standard contracts that allow community land trusts to participate in affordable housing development projects as limited partners who assume full ownership over time with conditions. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sagit Galai. I'm a paralegal and a researcher at Manhattan Legal Services. I work with the Inwood office. We've been working here for about a year and a half. I've represented many buildings and many tenants in eviction proceedings and aggression against their landlords. I'm going to talk a bit about this plan from the perspective of those tenants and from the breadth of experience that we have here as advocates. So many of the individuals who are scheduled to testify here today will or already have urged the office of the borough president to vote no on the current rezoning proposal. Such demands are based on a series of acute concerns shared by this community. That's why you're here. These concerns have been echoed in various hearings and marked this process until now. Federal housing policy in America was based on discrimination. Even the laudable aims of the New Deal had racist stereotypes and the ideology of segregation entrenched across all housing stocks in nearly every state. New York was not an exception to this rule. Neighborhoods like Inwood have historically suffered from disinvestment because of such housing policies and their perpetuation. When we look at the success of Inwood and its unwavering vibrancy, we need to heed that this place is what it is today because of incredibly resilient, working-class residents stayed and withstood that disinvestment in that disregard. This is what makes our city have the neighborhoods that we have in terms of the businesses, the culture, and the community. It is resilience and sometimes resistance which has allowed them to stay havens for proud working-class residents. So considering this history, it's not surprising that so many residents have come together to express their grievances and concerns. When we speak to our clients about the neighborhood changing, we hear anger and we hear dismay. Because despite this history of disinvestment and inadequate resources, now the city wants to shake things up and revitalize Inwood in a manner in which they believe will either directly exclude them, push them out, or just ignore their needs. Should these residents be forced into a position in which they have to accept the negative aspects of this proposal in order to acquire the positive elements it promises? Community improvement cannot remain contingent on rezoning policies, especially if neighborhoods where New Yorkers already have to struggle to pay rent, and they have to struggle beyond the struggle, and they attend the most segregated schools, and they have to contend with the most racist police. This plan is approved, Inwood's landlords and future developers will be preparing for a windfall of revenue, even though they've kept many of these buildings in horrible conditions for years. This past year, we dealt with far too many intransigent landlords who failed to fix their elevators when they're out, even though elderly and disabled tenants depend on them. Right?
Right.
There's a massive lack of heat right at the peak of winter. And now there's a new trend. Some of you may know about this from the organizing perspective. We have this new epidemic of cooking gas outages. Yes. That just are out for months, everybody gets hot plates, but yet they never get restored. And when they do get restored, the landlord gets to take an NCIA. So it should not be surprising this community has aimed to persuade the city to change this proposal. Community improvements such as affordable housing, bigger libraries, and better school resources, efficient public transportation, and community land trust can be created without upzoning across Inwood. It shouldn't be an option. At Disney, Legal Services NYC, and especially in our Inwood community office, as tenant advocates, we ask ourselves, who is this rezoning for? We're apprehensive that it's not for the current community. Nor is it for the current small businesses or the tenants, but rather it's for developers and for the more affluent newcomers that these landlords are banking on. And this raises the question, why does a vibrant, thriving community like Inwood need to accept rezoning in order to merit investment by the city? We believe that our clients and the broader Inwood community deserve all of the investment that ride on the coattails of rezoning, that they shouldn't have to face upzoning, displacement, and high gentrification to receive long overdue investment from their own city.
Michael, before you start the assembly woman.
like to have Assemblywoman Carmen De La Rosa say a few words. Thank you very much, Madam Assemblywoman, for being here.
My pleasure, and thank you. I did want to listen to the entire panel. I do have my staff that's here that's going to stay for the entire event. But I have to go to Community Board 8 in Marble Hill tonight. I'm going to be speaking to them about some of the work we're doing in Albany. As Gail said, I'm the Assemblywoman for the area. First of all, I want to thank Gail Brewer, Borough President, for putting this hearing together as part of the UDEP process. Thank you, Gail, for all the work that you're doing. So, most of us are here to listen to the community. I want to encourage you all, as you've been doing, to take this opportunity to participate and to express your concerns and your needs. I want to actually thank the community and the community board. I think that this process has been a difficult one, but at the end of the day, from the first plan I saw to this plan, there have been changes. And I think that is due to the work that the community has done. So I want to extend that appreciation to you all. Le quiero dar las gracias a la comunidad, porque creo que desde el primer plan que vimos a este plan hay una diferencia. Y eso es por la unidad y por las voces de la comunidad que han salido a hablar de sus necesidades. Así que le doy la gracia por eso. Speaking of the community, I think that the community board's resolution that was passed had some very good insight, was very professional, and was very thoughtful. I read the resolution, and I think that the feedback that was given by the community board was critical. So, as was said by the panel, our communities are tired of being left behind when it comes to resources. And we know that it is the responsibility of government to ensure that these resources come to our community, whether there is development or not. On my part, the areas of most concern is obviously the housing, the affordability component, and the ability for us to, if we choose to, develop responsibly while not taking away and while keeping the soul of Inwood. Creo que por mi parte, el área que tengo más problema o más preocupación es con la vivienda. Creo que es importante que si nosotros, si se hace una decisión de llevar a cabo la rezonificación o no, que el alma de Inwood permanezca. Que lo que nos trajo a esta comunidad, como mis padres que vinieron aquí en los 80, permanezca en esta comunidad. What makes us vibrant and what makes us Inwood has to remain. I want to see a strong preservation plan as we move forward in this process. Un plan de preservación para que las personas que han vivido en esta comunidad, ya dije, como mis padres, que tienen más de 40 años viviendo aquí, como mis vecinos, se puedan quedar y puedan vivir con dignidad. I want to see a plan where people are able to stay and live with dignity. A plan that looks at housing, that looks at the conditions of housing, that looks at the problems of preferential rent, which were mentioned. Obviously, I know that the rent laws are subject to state regulations, and I fully intend to continue to be a strong voice for the repeal of vacancy decontrol, the closing of preferential rent loopholes, and ensuring that rent stabilization laws are strengthened in Albany. And I know that that's a big part of what's happening up here. Yo entiendo de que las regulaciones que tienen que ver con vivienda, las leyes se pasan en Albany. Y sé que voy a continuar siendo una voz para asegurar que esas rentas, que los inquilinos estén empoderados por las leyes que se hacen en el estado, que tienen que ver con las regulaciones de renta. And in 2019, those laws will come before the state legislature. Small businesses are a critical part of our fabric, and I want to make sure that we see incentives that make them be able to stay here, but not only stay, because some of them will be able to stay. We want to see them thrive. We want to make sure that they're able to continue to offer what they've been offering to our communities for so long. There have been too many press conferences around businesses that are closing, and we want to make sure that these businesses stay here. On education, I want to see more investment. We need to see more investment in the quality of education. I have a four-year-old daughter who is going into pre-K in District 6, and I want to make sure that, like her, the other children in our community are able to have access to quality education. Early childhood is critical if we're going to move a workforce in Upper Manhattan. La calidad de la educación tiene que mejorar. Tenemos que asegurar que tenemos programas que desde temprana edad enseñan a nuestros niños para que ellos puedan ser una parte íntegra de la clase trabajadora de esta comunidad. Our high schools. We should not have to worry at every turn that a high school is closing in our district. And that is a problem that we've had far too much of time. We have to see more investments there, and we want to make sure that we see that going forward in this plan. Infrastructure. So I was recently appointed to be chair of the infrastructure subcommittee in the assembly. And infrastructure is something that I think is absolutely critical. We've seen what happens when infrastructure is ignored, and we want to make sure that that is something that this plan continues to look at. We want to see that if the capacity, as was mentioned here, grows, that the residents of Inwood grows, then we want to know that we have the infrastructures to serve them safely and to make sure that the people who live here do not see a downgrade in services. What are those services? Sanitation, our subway system, something we've seen in the news time and time again, our bus system, our network of buses are not functioning at the moment. We want to make sure that when these enhancements happen in our community, that we're also looking at accessibility, that we're looking at ADA compliance, that we're able to not just piecemeal the solutions for our transit system. Creo que es importante de que las soluciones de tránsito continúen en nuestra comunidad si vamos a agregar más personas. Es lógico de que tengamos un plan donde la comunidad no sufra de que los servicios de sanidad, de educación, de empleo bajen en la comunidad. As we also look at the environment, the access to the waterfront is important. I think that this plan takes a serious look at that, and we need to make sure that the investment in our public spaces, both green and blue, is there. Waterfront access is important, but we must also remember that this community is in a flood zone, and we do have flooding that has occurred here where we have hurricanes. We want to make sure that that is something that we also include in this plan. And obviously, the arts and the culture of this community. We know that we have gems in our community when it comes to art and culture. So many people live in this community, work in this community, and are artists. There's local artists, there's a thriving artist community. We do not want to see that community displaced. Sorry, I'll try to translate this part. No, acaban de informar que están arreglando los traductores, so voy a tratar de decir algunas palabras en español. So as I was saying, art and culture is important. As we look to invest in Inwood, that has to be a part that we make a serious investment in this plan. Where are our theater spaces? Where are our dance studios? Where are our music studios? That is something that we want to continue to see in this plan. And so, le queremos dar las gracias a la presidenta del condado. We want to thank Gail Brewer for this platform. I will look forward to continuing to work with my colleagues to make sure that at the end of this process, when the city councilman takes this vote, when Gail Brewer takes this vote, when the community board has already spoken, that the interest of the community is reflected in that plan, and that is the ultimate goal. Le quiero dar las gracias a la presidenta del condado y a mis colegas. Espero seguir trabajando con ellos para que las necesidades de esta comunidad sigan siendo reflexionadas en ese plan. Creo que cuando trabajamos unidamente y cuando ponemos la voz de la comunidad como prioridad, se puede lograr mucho. Sabemos que los cambios que está pasando en nuestra comunidad han estado pasando por mucho tiempo. Esto no comenzó hace 4 años, no comenzó hace 2 años cuando este plan se comenzó. Comenzó mucho antes. Entonces, si vamos a tener un cambio en nuestra comunidad, creo que las voces de la comunidad tienen que dirigir ese cambio. Así que le doy las gracias por tenerme aquí hoy.